Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who on the holy mount revealed to chosen witnesses your well-beloved Son, wonderfully transfigured in raiment white and glistening, mercifully grant that we, being delivered from the disquietude of this world, may by faith behold the King in his beauty, who with you, O Father, and you, O Holy Spirit, lives and reigns one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. A reading from the book of Exodus. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining. And Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 99, found beginning on page 728 in the Book of Common Prayer. We will recite the psalm together in unison. The Lord is King, let the people tremble. He is enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth shake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is high above all peoples. Let them confess his name, which is great and awesome. He is the Holy One. O mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and fall down before his footstool. He is the Holy One. Moses and Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among those who call upon his name. They called upon the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept his testimonies and the decrees that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them indeed. You were a God who forgave them, yet punished them for their evil deeds. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God, and worship him upon his holy hill. For the Lord our God is the reading from the second letter of Peter. I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to refresh your memory, since I know that my death will come soon, as indeed our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort so that after my departure you may be able at any time to recall these things. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we have been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James, and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep. But since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my Son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I'm fully aware that having read those words from the book of Exodus about Moses veiling and unveiling his face, that I had just removed a mask. And that if you look at those actions of Moses in relation to what he is saying and what he's doing in relation to God, that there is some resemblance to what we are doing sometimes in masses these days. Not just the celebrant, but those who are actually getting up, especially on Sunday mornings, and reading the Word of God, that we keep masks on for protection and for the safety of all, but at some very, very important, incredibly holy moments, we remove the masks. There's a practical reason that it's easier to hear, but we might think that there's something else behind that, that we're drawing attention to the fact that we want to make sure these words are heard, the Word of God proclaimed in Holy Scripture, in the Gospel preached in a sermon, and then that other time when we remove the mask for the Eucharistic prayer, where God himself comes to us in bread and wine. A friend of mine remarked recently, and I hadn't thought of this, and I think it's really spot on, that of course the masks that we are encouraged to wear and not think should be wearing these days are about protecting one another, protecting not just ourselves, but perhaps most importantly, those around us. But they also are the sign, this visible sign, that when we see someone with a mask, we remember we're in a perilous time. We're in a time where we can't do things as we normally would. And so the mask is not just a physical protection, but it's a reminder to us to keep our distance from other people so that we can respect their health and our own health and seek the well-being of all. When Moses goes up on Mount Sinai and God speaks to him, his mask is off, his veil is off. But when he comes down, he also keeps the veil off when he speaks those holy words. And through him, God shines some of that incredible glory to those around him. And then Moses puts the veil back on. Taking the veil on and off is drawing attention to God's glory, what that glory is saying to those around. We have to remember that this point in Exodus is the second time God gives the commandments. The first time the people really, really messed up. And the way in which they messed up was to make it all about them. They said, well, we're tired of waiting for whatever's happening while Moses is up on that mountain, and so we're going to make a calf for ourselves, we're going to do all these things. And of course, Moses is furious when he comes down, smashes the commandments, and then it's repeated again. So maybe that veil for those people at that time was a really helpful reminder that it's not about you, and that we need to remember it's about someone else, that all of this goes back to the root, it goes back to God. We get a reminder also in 2 Peter. Peter says, I think you all need to be reminded of this, that we witness these things now about the transfiguration of Jesus. Let us not forget, let's not lose that collective memory. The veil can remind us of that. And today, in our own time, these veils that we're wearing on our faces are helpful because there's another part of this story of the Transfiguration which harkens back to Jesus' baptism in the River Jordan, that the words are essentially the same. God says, this is my beloved Son, my chosen one. Listen to him. As if a spotlight comes down on Jesus, the central character, who is, of course, referring back to God, the central character. And it doesn't mean that some of that light from the spotlight doesn't reflect onto us, doesn't shine onto us. It does. But ultimately, the center spotlight is on God. What God is doing in Christ. But I fear that we have forgotten that. We don't come back time and time again enough to reflect on God's glory, to remember that we aren't the center of the universe, and that actually, paradoxically, whenever we think less of ourselves in a sense of humility, we are all the better for it, and our world is all the better for it. I think that's what, in some way, the masks are doing for us these days. No one wants to be in this situation, and whenever we are past this pandemic, which I pray will happen, and I'm hopeful will happen, it's not going to change the good that is happening then. It's not going to change the trauma now. But I hope we will be changed in some sense. I hope we will be changed to reflect more on what's present beyond ourselves, and ultimately reflect more on what God is doing in our lives, what God is doing in the world. And maybe we will put a little less of the spotlight on ourselves and focus more on the spotlight shining on God. And then we will see bits of that light shining in the faces of those around us. So when we have our masks on and off, we're reminded that life is sacred, that all that we have, everything around us, is imbued with something of the glory of God. It's there. We are to have reverence for it. These actions, just as Moses taking the veil on and off, just as Jesus being transfigured before the disciples, is a call to always bask in the glory of God and to seek it in God and not solely in ourselves. So may we go forward from this holy day finding the sacredness of God in all aspects. remember that always, always, that spotlight is on God who says to Christ, "You are my beloved, my chosen son, and we are to listen to him and only to him." In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the people, form six. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all
for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Daniel, our bishop, for Sean, Nora, Stephen, Nicholas, and Gordon, my priest brothers and sisters who minister in this place, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all of us who serve God and his church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation. We pray especially for all those who are sick with the coronavirus at this time. We pray for doctors, nurses, and medical professionals, and for essential workers who are putting their lives at risk for the sake of others. We pray for all who have been affected by Hurricane Isaias, for those who are rebuilding in its aftermath, for those who died, and for those who were injured. We pray for those who were affected in Lebanon by the explosion. We pray for an end to racial injustice in this nation and across the world. And we pray for all who are sick and in need of prayer, and especially those beloved of this parish at this time, for Chris, George and Sue, Tom, Kent John, George, John, Homer, Mary Jane, Marlene, Mark, Richard, Charlie, Will, Kathy, Nikki, Paul, Sarah, Lee, Jan, Nanette, Jean, Claire, Mike, Bill, Janet, Gary, Armand, T.R., and those we name in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We thank you for all who minister and serve in this parish, those who are reaching out to those in need during this time of pandemic. We thank you for the ministries of Daniel, Gabby, and Eleanor during this time, and for all of their hard work. We thank you. will exalt you, O God our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, especially Tom, and all those who have died of the coronavirus in the past day, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them,
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. Blessed are you, O Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice of my hands for the praise and glory of his name, both for our good and that of all his holy church. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with blessed Mark the Evangelist, and with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to this supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Thank you.
sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace,
and grant us strength and courage
to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.